from similar background, but a renowned academician who has been from the science side, and he has been a pioneer of innovation in the academic side, and he has won various awards. I would ask him to come on stage, and Nitin Deshpande, please come.
There is a more of us in voices. I don't know. You know, either C. I think C, yes, starts from yes. I think there is a connect between, you know, software and voices, looks like. I come from a little bit different background. We heard it was a great learning experience what Anand spoke, because it comes from a deep insight, because he is going through, and it was a great learning experience. You know, 30 years who built the company, 30 years who build the institution, and my experience in academia is 3 years. But previously, I was in the industry. So I come from the industry, worked in multinational company like GE, Honeywell, and worked for a company like Reliance. And prior to that, I did my PhD in physics, went abroad, did a lot of research, and developed products and so on. So here is a 25 years experienced person, and with 3 years of recent academic experience. So let me compliment C, because this was truly courageous to bring academia into this particular discussion. I'm saying so because I get to speak in various platforms around the world on the topic of innovation and entrepreneurship, but there has never been a request to speak about innovation and entrepreneurship in the context or in this context of how can we embed innovation in our learning process. This is the first time, and that that courage to bring somebody like me here and speak about learning innovation in education is very, very unique. And thanks to Ashutosh for many reasons, because he persuaded, we met, and things happened. So let me take. So what I'm going to speak in the next 30 minutes is what is happening in the world, my perspective, because I travel a lot, what's happening in India, my point of view about India, and then I get into the Indian IT industry and then bring it down to my experiment about bringing innovation into the learning process. So what is happening? I think all of us, Anand spoke, Dr. Anita Patankar spoke, that the world is changing very, very rapidly. The way we think, the way we live, the way we work is changing extremely fast. We are talking about not just a changing world, but rapidly changing world, and we are talking about exponentially changing technology and so on. So that linear, the exponential, all these things are happening, technology is changing. And in this changing world, which also brings a lot of uncertainty and also a big opportunity. So what are the key trends that I see in the world, or from a global and Indian perspective? For me, when I was looking at all the kinds of recessions in the past, say, 100 years, the 2008 recession has been a very different kind of a recession. I always call this 2000 has reset the world. At this 2008, because every time there was a recession, and after a few years, we used to come back. I think that was the cyclicity, predictable cyclicity that we always saw. But after 2008 recession, still, the companies and nations are yet to come out of that particular recession. And there are so many things that are happening. And one of the things that I see, the effect of 2008, is the significant reduction in the income levels in USA, Canada, and many developed world. Just to give you statistics about what is happening and how the economy or income levels or the people around the world that you can see. Surprisingly, 40% of Americans today believe that they have fallen into lower income. It has never happened like this. Just 19% increase in their household income between 1967 and 2013, which is too small for a nation or developed country like the United States. If I come to Europe, in France, every salary has fell 24%, but the expenses have gone up by 30%. If you look at Germany, 58%, Germany is one of the strongest economies in the world, and even in Germany, 58% of Germans find that they have dropped, that the percentage has dropped from 65% to 58%. That's the kind of income levels are dropping down, even a country like Germany. And if you look at the poverty in Japan, earlier the poverty was somewhere 1.3% in 1980, now that has increased to 16%, which is a dramatic change. And with this particular change, you see the world differently. And when I'm giving these particular statistics, I'm associated with the Center for Frugal Innovation in Germany, which is getting a lot of funding to do research. What does this particular mean from an innovation perspective? And what we see, and there's a lot of literature that is available in the Center for Frugal Innovation in Germany, that how Germans, or particularly Europeans, are trying to buy things differently. Now they want to buy the products and solutions, not like big is the better. Everybody was trying to buy bigger and better and more sophisticated and so on. Now they are trying to buy something which is affordable, which is a good quality and so on. And there's a lot of things that I see changing, and that has a relevance for Indian industry in India. The second trend that Anand also alluded to is that the life of a company, and that life is substantially reducing when we compare, say, 1960s. In 1960s, if I look at the companies in S&P 500 list, the life of the company used to be 60 to 70 years, and today it has dropped down to 15 to 17 years. It's very interesting. But what is surprising more than this is that the 75% of the companies who are in S&P 500 are not going to be there by 2027, which is just 10 years from now. Those large corporations are not going to be in that particular list, which means that something fundamentally is changing in this rapidly changing world. The technology is changing very fast. We are talking about exponential technology, we are talking about artificial intelligence, robotics, biotech, manufacturing, all kinds of things. And that has a relevance to the industry, and we just heard how that is going to impact the IT industry, particularly in India. But this is also an opportunity. In fact, day before yesterday, I was in Hubli, which is 400 kilometers from here, and I'm on the board of Sandbox Startup, which is going to build India's largest incubator, and I went to one corner room. There's a company called Linksys, and today that Linksys has developed a product based on IoT, which has sensors, which has hardware, which has a software, which is unique in the world. Young kids developing at the corner, and I asked him, who is your competitor? He says, at this stage, there is no one competing with me, because I'm giving end-to-end solution for any manufacturing company that wants to use. I said, what is the response time? I was just listening to Microsoft recent, one of the developers program. They said that Sandvik has reduced the response time from somewhere between minutes to 30 milliseconds, and here is a kid in Hubli talking about 100 milliseconds and says that I can bring it down to 30 seconds. That's the power and that entrepreneurs have, innovators have, because of access to various technologies. There's a big emphasis. Trump may not believe this, but the world believes this, and there's a lot of opportunity in sustainability when it comes to the innovation, because now the world and many developed countries want the products which are sustainable, and they're willing to pay more. And there's a lot of research, a lot of innovation happening in the area of sustainability. What's happening in India? If you look at in India, India is a bright spot among all these different emerging world, and we say it's a bright spot because this is the most, of course, it is, there is a lot of recent discussion that it has lost that tag of fastest growing economy in the world. Still it is growing at, you know, 7%+. And what is expected is that very soon, in a decade or two, you will see that India will become one of the largest or third largest economy in the world, which is a good for any industry that we see. And currently, it is the 9th largest economy in the world. And where is the big market today? When we look at the world, why the world is looking at India is because there is a great aspirational middle class that is growing apart from the people who are resource poor. They are the bottom of the pyramid. But what is happening is that these aspirational middle class wants the products and solutions that the rich people want. And there's a lot of innovation that is happening. And that will lead. In fact, there are so many reports which talk about what is the market size of this aspirational middle class. They talk, again, between $500 billion to $1 trillion. Numbers are mind-boggling. So there are 5 trends that I talk and I'm sharing. Of course, there are many things that are happening in the world, but the key 5 are, there are emerging markets, global economies under pressure, sustainability has a lot of importance, and we are living in a globalized, hyper-connected digital world with all kinds of new technologies coming, and businesses and industries are getting disrupted. If they don't disrupt themselves, somebody else is going to disrupt, which means that we have some relevance as an IT industry. There is some relevance to these changing things around the world. So when I look at, you know, after working in science, after working in the industry, and now after working in academia, what I see is that this can be one of the greatest opportunity of the decade. And what I'm saying, if the developed world is looking at products and solutions, which is something relevant or something applicable to the aspirational middle class of India, because we understand what the Indian market is and what Indian consumer wants, and if we can marry this, not only we can develop a product in India, but also we can, same product or same solution can be sold in the developed world. But the best part of this opportunity is that it is not going to just create the wealth, but it is also going to create better and sustainable world. This is very, very unique. I have been studying IT industry, of course. I don't have as much deep knowledge as Anand has because he's part of that industry. What I've seen, you know, I wrote an article recently in one of the magazines, how this, you know, what is the connect between, you know, innovation, IT, and the Indian economy? What is the relationship between that? And I was looking at how the Indian industry has evolved. And as many of us, we know, it started somewhere in 1990 with quite a problem. Then it went on, now 2010 to 2016, it's all about value focus. Still, of course, there's a lot of work that comes, which is on a low end or kind of thing, but many companies are engaging the Indian companies, which has a relevance to the business transformation, it has a relevance to create the value or co-create certain things. But the next growth that I see when I talk to TCS, when I talk to Infosys, when I talk to many other companies like Tech Mahindra and so on, what I see is that there's a big, big aspiration to grow based on the competitive advantage of your innovation and intellectual property. Because today, if I'm offering a solution just based on number of people, and that was the driver of growth for the Indian IT industry till recently, now that will not really enough to offer our value. It has to be IT-based or innovation-based competitive advantage, and that will create a lot of wealth and jobs, and the economy can grow. But when I looked at the large companies in India, let's look at TCS, which is one of the largest Indian company. When I looked at their patterns, of course, patterns are not the only indicators of innovation. There are many, many other ways you can innovate, even business model, delivery model. There are many process innovation and so on. But just to get a sense that how much a company like TCS is investing in the creation of a technology which differentiates with respect to the intellectual property. And you'll be surprised that as of now, TCS has close to 2,537 patents still today. Of course, I'm not given the numbers till 2017 because it will create a confusion. And there are over 500 granted patents. look at the company of a size of a TCS having only 2,500 patents, and out of which only 500. And if you look at the large companies in the world, every day they file 10 patents. So that's the kind of a, so if you look at the aspiration, but the investment to create the new technology, which is IP differentiated, is not much. It doesn't compare with the size. But if I look at Infosys, in fact, you know, I always used to wonder, Infosys sitting on billions and billions of dollars in cash. Why don't they invest in innovation entrepreneurship? I have my own point of view, which I will not share here. But if I look at the patent, in fact, in the Infosys, the patents, the number of publications that you see, the number of applications that you see is dropping down. It's not going up. So it tells us something very interesting, and their numbers are not much. A company of a size of Infosys has 384 granted patent out of 1,000 applications, which is declining, which is not going up in spite of the changing. Of course, we have quarterly issues, we have revenues and all those things, market and which helps, but I think there's something wrong fundamentally in the IT industry. And we did, Dr. Mashulkar and I, we co-authored an article about how India has evolved as a R&D destination. And surprisingly, the multinational companies based in India and through Indian talent, how much IP they are contributing to the world of their global entity, you'll be surprised that, see, in 2003 I looked at hardly, Naval has only 4% of their patents, at least where one of the inventors was from India. But today, 28% of their IP or patents, mainly, comes from India. 28% is not a small number. Symantec, 24%, 2003, hardly there is anything. Adobe, 15%, Honeywell, 11%, or Apple, 10%, TI, 9%, and Cisco, 5%. That, what it means, I think the multinational companies are leveraging Indian talent to create intellectual property. And some of the companies, I worked for GE, the moment I came to GE, in the first 2 or 3 years, I had few patents. And good patents, US 5, all around the globe, which means the multinational companies are doing something very interesting when it comes to the IP creation. Now, I was talking about large companies. Look at a Bangalore-based EDM, a small company, which has hundreds of patents. And one of their business model is to license the technology that is created in Bangalore, in India, by the Indians. It's a very interesting model. If you study the ETM, a small company like ETM has been able to create IP and win the business based on the IP, but the large companies have not been able to do this. But multinational companies are leveraging this particular Indian challenge. I met Dr. Mashulkar when he came from Australia after 1 year, 1 month of his professorship, and I was talking to him, where is the fundamental problem in the startups in India? And I was giving many insights, and one of the things I told, that Indian startups are not innovating because they are just trying to copy or have a problem and have one solution, and just they're investing heavily to evolve that particular solution that is not going to work when it comes to succeeding. And the moment I said, I think May 20, Dr. Mashulkar tweeted that this is serious, because innovation is a very important thing, because IBM said, one of the reports, not that everything that IBM has brought out, some 6-7 parameters why Indian companies are not successful, you may agree or may not disagree, but one thing that is based on my experience, because I've worked with so many startups, is that 90% of Indian startups are failing because of lack of innovation. I think this is something that we need to do to really reinvent or reinvigorate this startup ecosystem as well. Now, if you look at what are the skills that are required, now I'm slowly connecting this to the education, or even for a talent that exists in the companies. So if you look at the recent report from World Economic Forum, and which the title of the report is Future of Jobs, and very, very interesting changes that you see, that the top 10 skills that were required in 2015 and top 10 skills that are required in 2020 are different, and there are a lot of changes. In 2015, it was problem solving, coordination, people management, critical thinking, and so on. Creativity was number 10, critical thinking was 4, and of course problem solving. It was dominated predominantly in the management skills. But come to 2020, Of course, problem solving remains important, but the first three things, critical thinking and creativity, is all about innovation. It's all about creativity, it's all about ideation, it's all about finding creative, innovative solutions. That's a very, very interesting skills that the world needs. And if you look at, you know, emotional intelligence did not exist top 10. Now we are talking about emotional intelligence and cognitive flexibility. These are all indicators that the talent that we have to create, a talent we need to nurture and upskill, requires all these skills. I think this is very, you know, important message. So how are we going to do this? Is it possible only that the corporates will do, because corporates have their own challenges, they have their own reasons, you know, to the kind of an extent they can invest in upskilling the talent. Of course, Anand said, you know, gave the deep insight, you know, 40-year-old versus the young. So, in symbiosis, because as Dr. Anita Patankar said, symbiosis is always pioneer in developing new courses, which was sometimes ahead of time, like banking finance or telecom, which, you know, Dr. Mujumdar, a great visionary, a great leader, education leader, he spotted that this is an opportunity, this is the kind of talent that is required for the industry, he created the institution. So, when I had taken my break from my corporate career, I wanted to contribute to society and so on. So, one day I got a call from Dr. Vidya saying that Dr. Mujumdar wants to meet you. And I went and met him. You know what he said, Dr. Chinchure? Whole of our education system, including Symbiosis, is preparing children, kids, for a job. Placement is the top criteria. Can we create a course which will help to create new jobs? Can we do something in innovation entrepreneurship? And that is how the origin of India's first two-year full-time residential and experiential MBA course on innovation entrepreneurship was born. I said I would contribute, and we created a very, very differentiated, very different course, 2 years course, where management subjects are taught, but only for 25-30%, but rest is all about innovation entrepreneurship, and it is not just the classroom, it is all experiential. So in the first semester, it's all about finding the problem. Second semester is all about finding the solution. Third semester is all about design and prototype. And fourth semester, nothing else, but the student should go out and implement in a smaller scale, and we said we'll get the investors, and you can start a new venture. And this has been a 3-year journey, and I was doing a lot of experiments with this course. I would have given more details because of the time that I'm not giving, but the philosophy of this course when I was designing is, it has to be, we have to be, our education system is designed for industrial era. So we have to move from teaching to learning, but learning is not efficient. We need to move from a learning to experiential learning. But experiential learning is also not enough, because in the campus with a couple of thousand students who are looking for a job, and here are these 40 students looking to create the jobs, which means there's a lot of, you know, challenges to keep their motivation level. So I said that it has to be inspired experiential learning, and that experiential learning has to come from two ways, that people, you and me, who are in the industry, share their learning, and other students, you know, do certain things and learn themselves. And that has resulted into a very, very interesting, this is the first batch I remember, which we are running in the SIB, Symbiosis Institute of Business Management. So I would just like to give just a glimpse of what our students are doing, because it's not in the media. We have never promoted innovation entrepreneurship, because I was particularly interested that we first prove, we experiment, we see what works, what doesn't work, and then go to the media. Amri, he joined the first batch, and his brother was disabled. And he had he knew what are the challenges of a disabled student or a kid in India, because when he used to take his brother to the school, that many did not have any simple wheelchair, and the wheelchair used to be like, you know, plastic chair converted into a wheelchair, forget about motorized, you know, wheelchair. And their motorized wheelchairs are very, very expensive, but it is required. So what he said when he came in the first semester, he said that through this particular course, I want to develop a solution for the disabled people by creating affordable but motorized, powerful wheelchair. And in the first semester, he had only three. He went and he pitched this in a Godrej Loud competition, Dare to Dream, and he won the prize, and Nisaba Godrej not only gave the money, but also the mentorship. Where does his product stand? Because it's a technology product. I thought, you know, I will just show a minute of a video. It's still a prototype, so you can watch the video, just get a feel, you know, how he has been able to develop it. This is the first batch of students. The second batch of students, one of the students, now he just passed out of this particular course, developed a VR technology, Aman and Shubham. And Aman has a ceramic tiles retail business, and he had a problem to convert the, you know, the people who come and convert them into a real consumer. And the challenge was that how can they really experience how styles and many other building materials look when it is displayed in their home. So they developed the VR technology, and now they have 3 customers. And yesterday when I called up Virali Aman, he says he was in Ambika working with one of the customers and very dedicated. And when they went for a competition, they won every competition. Wherever they were, either they won or they were top finalists. And the situation was that I had to stop, I had to tell him enough of not winning the competition. But by winning competition, they created their own seed money. And now they're using their own seed money to continue developing a product. And now some of these customers are saying that, can you give us exclusivity about this? It's amazing. And some of the software was developed in India and also in US, because as you know, some of the skills are not available. We said, these are the students who are part of this innovation entrepreneurship course, how we can help the extended community. See, we ran a 10 lakhs startup idea competition. And one of the students who won the competition is not from innovation entrepreneurship. Of course, innovation entrepreneurship students were second and third or something. But I think it was a student from liberal arts who won the first prize. And it was a 10 lakh, very rigorous process. And we had few hundred ideas. Registered, and the whole idea was how we can now galvanize the entire Symbiosis towards innovation and entrepreneurship and so on. And after successful that, we said that we need to support, create a platform to support the alumni of Symbiosis. And one of the alumni that we have been supporting and mentoring is SRV Media, which was started by Vikram and Rohit from Symbiosis Center for Information Technology. When they came out of the institute, they started this company, and today they are $2 million company. And every customer, including Symbiosis, one of their clients, every client who comes not only sticks, but continues to give more and more business. And the kind of a differentiated products And also the kind of proprietary algorithm that they have developed is it's giving the guaranteed results for large companies and also for educational institution. So based on my experience, you know, when I was asked to write this article and share, you know, how can we create that innovation learning or embedding innovation learning into the educational institution? I was just thinking, what is the right thing that we are doing, or what is the thing that we can learn from, say, Silicon Valley or Boston? I spent a lot of time there. How they are different and what we are doing different. So I created this 3P model. It's a very simple, I think, in any educational institution, if real learning has to happen, the kind of skills that we are talking about, whether it's critical thinking, creativity, innovation, and many others, that we need to have the right programs. Without the programs, I'm not sure this will work. Voluntarily work for some time, but otherwise, you can have a hackathon. For example, one of the biggest hackathon that happened, and Anand tweeted many times, you know, the kind of impact that it created was just having hackathon. It's not that every time we have to have 2-year, you know, MBA program for innovation entrepreneurship. We can create small programs for solving social problems, the business problems, and learn from these. The next is you have to create platforms, because particularly in education institutions like university, you have diversity of students from liberal arts, from engineering, from law, from IT, from, you know, MBA and so on. How can we create the platform so that the better ideas are generated and better solutions are created and they learn from each other? So we have to create a platform. For example, we have given both platforms, like having an innovation council, to all the way creating a software virtual platform where anybody has an idea, they can put it in the idea. It's a startup wing which started in Silicon Valley. So it's a virtual platform where you have access to all the investors from, you know, US and India, to all the students, community, mentors, and everybody who can comment and refine their idea, so that ultimately this platform can take your idea all the way to an investable idea, or you can start a new company. But it is not enough to have just programs and platform. You need to have a basis. And today, in a educational institution, property is very precious, particularly in big cities. So many times what happens is they don't have the spaces where the creativity, where students can come, faculty can come together and spend time together. It could be cafes, it could be, you know, a learning center. There are many creative places that we need to create within the campus so that the students and faculty and many others get attracted and they physically meet and discuss and so on. So like in Boston, we have a stuck innovation cafe or a cafe which is free. Once in a week, people can come and meet and so on. And similarly, many other different places. I think these are the 3 P's which will differentiate whether we are embedding innovation into the education or not. Today, what is happening, many of the education institutions are doing here and there, oh, let's experiment with hackathon, or let's do some idea competition, which has been very sporadic and ad hoc, and sometimes it does not give the solid results. Of course, this also has a relevance to the corporates, in case you want to. And whenever there is a report that gets released, I have written a detailed article around what this 3 P's means. So Dr. Mashankar is a mentor, is a role model for many of us in Pune. What he wrote recently is that, he says, I believe a time has come. So far we were competing on the cost arbitrage, we were competing on labor arbitrage. Now the time has come that when India does not just develop the innovative technology that are first in India and first in the world, and he keeps talking about it in many, many platforms, the time has come, we have the potential, and there are many indications, and there is an opportunity to do this. But in order to develop the technology or innovation or any other solution, it is important that at least we do two most important things. Number one is that Indian talent, when I say Indian talent, it is students to all, you know, working professional, we need to empower them with the science, art, and practice of innovation. And there's a science, lot of science that exists in this process of innovation. I think it's very, very important that we have or we empower the people. Now, when I talk, when I go to many, many companies, you know, the CEO is saying that we need to innovate, but many times that does not percolate to the middle management or even to the employees. And then middle level management, what if the senior management, they create some programs and here and there, it goes to L&D. L&D is not going to really understand, you know, how to build innovation mastery or understand the entire process of, you know, science and practice of innovation. What they do, what they're doing is they're just inviting people who can train the tools. Now the tools, you know, the trainers come, they train the tool, I mean, they train a particular tool or set of tools, but they don't see the impact. And one of the reasons for this is that there is no foundational knowledge about innovation. And unless we have a foundation, no matter how many tools are important, how many tools that we learn, it is not going to create an impact. So there are two most important things: foundational knowledge, which can come from the academia, plus the industry where we provide that knowledge to the employees. The next is the overall holistic strategy for innovation. If we combine all these three things and we can see the real impact that can happen. The next is, I think the time has come that no matter, you know, we may think, we may not think, we may feel that it's appropriate, not appropriate, it's extremely important that the educational institutions and industry has to come together to make whatever, you know, dream that we want to achieve, to build the right skills and competencies right from the beginning. So first time when I was working in Associated, when I was an employee, I was associated with Symbiosis Law School. I said, we have lawyers, we have judges, but they have no knowledge about science, technology, and innovation. So we created a course, I designed a course for IP students, law students, plus the human rights students. Human rights students should understand, you know, how science is done, how technology is done, and how the innovation is done, so that they are better prepared, whether it is in advocacy or when the law students, they go and become lawyers or become judges. So, and this can happen. So if industry wants a talent, I think industry has an obligation. Just expecting that we need to get a particular set of talent is not going to work. And particularly in this changing world, that both academia and education institutions have to come together to achieve the kind of a dream that we have, or kind of a opportunity that we want to leverage, and that opportunity is with us. It does not matter whether somebody is in Hubli or somebody is in Boston, somebody is in Silicon Valley or Pune. Today we have a tremendous opportunity to create wealth, but most importantly is create jobs. And there's so much of discussion that is happening within. I work with Chris Gopalakrishnan to many others as a part of CII. There's a lot of discussion that is happening. If we want to create more and more jobs, of course more and more wealth, and if you want to see that India prospers, Indian economy grows, I think that it is not a choice. Innovation is not a choice, but it's an imperative. And I'm sure, I think C and all of you will come together to create that prosperity for India. Thank you very much.
To particularly address the situation of how quantum computing is going to affect the industry, particularly in the field of cryptography. Because, and I'm using this as an example for my question. Earlier stages, we were kind of dependent on non-deterministic problems for ensuring that cryptography stays the way it is. But in the face of quantum computing, that's slowly changing. What happened, what used to be a huge problem, is becoming a much more minute problem. So in a situation like that, if we have a startup in India that is focusing on cryptography, what do you suggest that startup could do? Should the startup stick to the older ways and try to innovate incrementally, or should they move to a better platform, for example, Quantum?
I think, understood. So whether it is an individual as a startup or whether it is a corporation, it is not about betting on a particular idea or a particular, you know, solution or particular area. It's always about the portfolio, where you have a big bets, high risk big bets, but there are incremental things and somewhere in between. So if you look at it, as I think Anand was also talking, you know, unless we create that model, I don't think we are going to. Now, whether quantum computing is going to happen, it is going to happen. Why it did not happen, there are many reasons. And one of the reasons is that we need to look at the industry. Now, industry, the silicon industry, which had invested billions and billions of dollars to build the, you know, capacity and foundry and so on, they are not going to change so fast. So reinvesting several billions of dollars to create a new foundry is not going to happen. But when the technology is really, really differentiates and it is possible, it will certainly happen, and we have seen this. You know, if you look at all the technologies that are, you know, right from any technology, it has gone through all the cycles, and eventually it will happen. So now, if industry doesn't do, somebody else will do. Now, whether startups should do it, if they think that this is the best way to do it, they should do it. So, but I think what Anand said is extremely important. I think that's the biggest insight. It is not about quantum computing. If you say that cryptography is your domain, you need to find the best solution. With quantum computing or no quantum computing, with this imaging or no imaging. That is a consequence. That's a, you need to see, you know, what is the best way for you. You cannot start the work, I will do this cryptography to quantum computing, may or may not. So you are taking a big risk. Okay, thank you very much. I think we have to listen to the story.